shouldn't be treated the same way as the word them, because them means blood, and it was being used to refer to something which isn't chemically blood, but it itself is chemically blood. But this would not be applicable to the word alaqa. We would say no, this is not the case, because the hadith itself talks about two dead things and two blood things, and the two dead things in question were not actually dead.
In this video, I will analyze Muhammad Hijab's video titled Sapient Thoughts Number 9. Does the word alaqa only mean congealed blood, and is it unscientific? So let me first address the title that is worded as a question. Does the word alaqa only mean congealed blood? No. Is it unscientific? Yes. Highly. Hi guys. Welcome back and thank you for joining me when I dissect and analyze a video made by a Muslim apologist who, as my experience shows, has no clue when it comes to anything even remotely scientific. He has published a video talking about a single word used a couple of times in the Quran, which is alaqa,
the word alaqa,
usually as in clinging something, usually taken to be a clot of blood. So let me first take a look at the word itself and then the context, and then we're going to compare the claim to what we find and then explain what led to my conclusion above. So here's some options. We have dozens of meanings and usages. Because there's no further explanation or context, we're faced with a useless set of interpretations, unable to narrow it down to a single piece of information. However, if we go what hundreds of years of study and hundreds of scholars are presenting us with, we see that they all refer to something hanging on to something. If we look at almost a dozen sentences describing the creation of humans by a supernatural creator God, and focus only on the four usually taken as reference for the most detailed description, we get the following. And right off the bat, we see the glaring contradiction between one claim from an extract of clay and the next claim, which is from dust. Two very different things, very vague, very ambiguous, and very unscientific. Now, the last statement is totally false, since we have multiple genders, procreation options, and sexual preferences. What is interesting to see is what happens when you go outside of the Quran and outside of Islam, and look what Greek medicine was saying at the time, which we know is wrong when compared with today's knowledge, but we can still use it. So 2,000 years ago, we find all the words and the sequences mentioned in the Quran by the Greeks. And then we have a bridge, a hospital, which was frequented by both Arabs and Greeks, where the 5th century understanding of human anatomy could have been transferred between the groups. And here, in the Quran, we find the Greek understanding of human development in the womb, described in stages, using expressions, reflected what was visible to the people at the time, to Arabs and Greeks alike. And Arabs developed the language and used a word they knew, alaqa, to describe the sequence they had possibly learned from the Greeks. Now, taking the historical context into consideration, we have Greek medicine of antiquity, and this is being made available to Arabs who proceed to show off this modern understanding in stories which are being recited and then told at campfires and eventually make it into their newest book, the Quran, a product of the early medieval era. So let's look at the word itself, alaqa. Dictionaries give us multiple possibilities of how to use the word, actually making it pretty useless for anything. Now, the Quran itself, however, uses the word in a rather uniform manner when it comes to human embryonic development. And here's how it is usually applied. Okay, so next, let's look at the context. And this is one of the sentences it is used as. Okay, so we see the clinging substance, and we see the clot into a lump of flesh, and we see Yusuf Ali, who also says, then of that clot we made a lump. That is what the understanding was at the time. So where do I begin here? Well, let's take a step back. First off, embryology is the study and explanation, description of how different life forms are formed and how they develop. And in mammals, like us humans, we have different elements, like gonads producing gametes, which through a process of fertilization result in a zygote, leading to the development of an embryo, where the formation, and this is important, skin, brain, eyes, nose, ears, mouth, teeth, tongue, tonsils, lungs, liver, intestines, stomach, bones, muscles, ligaments, cartilage, toenails, nipples, hair, lips, kidneys, nerves, glands, cells, and on, how these are formed. That is what embryology is. And none of that is found in the Quran. So, no, the Quran does not have anything to say about embryology. All the Quran does is talk about a supernatural creator slash God creating humans, handmade, with using dozens of different and contradictory materials, all handcrafted, mentioning details which are the opposite of what we find in the real world. And nothing, absolutely nothing, is correct. The only organ that is mentioned only like over and over is the heart, which, according to the Quran, is used to think. And that's wrong as well. And that's how bad it is. So, just to recap, we have several sentences in the Islamic Quran describing different ways human beings are created, using different materials, and completely wrong terms and processes. And now, an uneducated Muslim apologist is trying to convince us that a word used to describe what people 2,000 years ago observed and then interpreted in the wrong way is actually correct when changing the Arabic language used in the book. Now, the guy in the video, a Muhammad Hijab, has no clue what science is, has no idea how science works, and I've shown this multiple times in several videos, and he does not understand embryology either. But still, he rambles on and on without really making much sense. The only thing he tries to bring across is that 1,000 years of scholarly research are to be ignored, and his personal opinion is to be inserted instead. He says he's addressing theophilosophical issues, where this is one of biology. His central argument is that if something appears like something, it can be taken as that something.
That something which is not blood in chemical composition can yet be referred to as blood, if it has the aesthetic appearance of that.
This is quite silly. I mean, this might appear like Muhammad, but is it Muhammad? And this famous picture shows a pipe that is not a pipe, as it's just a drawing of one. Okay, so let's turn to the video now and take his claims apart and then inspect them a bit.
Where we discuss theophilosophical issues, where we refute those arguments made, those specious arguments that are made by the detractors of Islam.
We critics, we take claims made in the Quran and by Muslim apologists. All we do is check the veracity of these claims. So we don't have arguments, but refutations. So if he wants to refute them, he needs to construct arguments based on evidence that the claims made are indeed correct and our refutations wrong. He can't just try to refute our refutations by calling them arguments and simply claim we are wrong. So it's not just me coming up with arguments. I'm just reacting to something that I am confronted with. Now, Hijab waffles and simply tries to appeal to his audience, impressionable, uneducated Muslims.
Which is that the Quran allegedly says, according to these detractors, that I've seen their material on anti-Islamic websites, that the Quran, that the human being is made up from a congealed clot of blood. And we know from embryological study that that is not the case.
No, it's not allegedly. The Quran actually uses the word alaka multiple times, as I've shown previously. Hijab tries so hard to make critics look bad that he doesn't give himself time to think and he trips all over himself. That's one of the reasons nobody outside the Islamic world takes him seriously anymore. He simply has no case and is unable to present one either. He does not seem to understand the problem, or maybe he's just unable to formulate it. The problem is that the descriptions provided in the Quran do not represent reality. They are not correct. And it's not just a word, it's the entire process that is completely wrong. Alaka, as we've seen, can have multiple meanings in the Arabic language, which is why Arabic is ill-equipped to be accurate and precise, something we require in science. So assigning the word a different contents is insufficient to rescue the Quran. But that's all that Hijab's attempting to do. Whether he succeeds or fails here does not necessarily change the outcome, as the other factors remain factually incorrect. What I find quite funny is the shift of body language, where he starts off quite confident and, as his story progresses, gets less and less confident, and he starts shifting around and tries to mask his insecurity. And he digs himself even deeper and claims this meaning was not assigned to the word by early scholars. Yet a quick check on what Ibn Kathir, the Jalalains, or Ibn Abbas say, they understood exactly what we understand today, what the Quran says. It follows Greek medicine, calling it a clot, something we know today is wrong. And Ibn Abbas even adds like these time spans, which make the wrong even wronger, much wronger, the wrongerest. But that's what we find in the hadith for some reason. So Muhammad did not correct anything, he made matters worse. But Hijab simply ignores all of this and claims the opposite without providing any form of evidence, just his say-so, blaming it on the Arabic language, something an all-knowing author should have been aware of. So bringing up some name who says something and providing his personal opinion doesn't really help if the god didn't know how to formulate this in the Quran.
Medieval scholars from the very early days of Islam were mentioning in their treatises, in their dictionaries, and in their exegetical and commentarial works, that in fact, alaqa does mean to be attached to or connected to.
Attached or connected to what? That is the problem. That is the mistake in the Quran. And this is the central problem with the word alaqa. And Hijab leaves it unanswered. Instead, he goes off into the distance, making silly claims about appearances and reality, which don't reflect reality either, vividly demonstrating that he's totally lost. His adding some obscure hand-picked words from the sayings of Muhammad are probably the worst apologetics I've ever heard, where two bloods. Suddenly represent man and woman and their gametes, the sex cells themselves, going through the process of fertilization. That's amazingly silly.
And we know that the embryo has the aesthetic appearance of something which is congealed and bloody.
Really? No.
It shouldn't be treated the same way as the word dam, because dam means blood, and it was being used to refer to something which isn't chemically blood, but it itself is chemically blood. But this would not be applicable to the word alaqa. We would say no, this is not the case, because the hadith itself talks about two dead things and two blood things, and the two dead things in question were not actually dead.
Please feel free to explain to me what this Hijab thing is trying to tell us, because my eyes just glazed over. I've got no clue what he's doing. Saying the opposite within just seconds. Now, the video with Hijab does little to alleviate the doubts Muslims have today. It vividly demonstrates the intellectual level of the feeble excuses and desperate attempts to come up with something, anything, to say something that somehow sounds as though it rescues the pitiful quality of the Quran and teachings of Islam. That's why Muslims today are leaving Islam. Because the word alaqa is quite simply not something that can be accurately used to describe anything in the wider context of the formation of a new life form. And Hijab is, once again, hurting the Islamic rescue effort more than helping it. And that is what we see. And this is not the only thing that we see that is wrong in the Quran. And that is why Muslims are starting to doubt the Quran.
Why use the word alaqa when the Arabs had another word for the word fetus, which actually the Quran uses?
And this, it gets laughable towards the end, really, when Hijab says the Arabic language has the word fetus. When we are talking of first, you know, we're talking about an embryo, not a fetus. He really has missed the issue and failed to address the huge problem, one of those kind of problems that destroy the credibility of the Quran. Which means it was written by humans, obviously. Thanks, guys. See you again in the next video. If you like, a thumbs up. If you don't, thumbs down. And we'll see you in the next video. Bye for now.